Ah, Christmas. We all love it. The sights, the sounds, the tastes, the smells, and of course, the movies. All the classics. Elves in tights, flying reindeer, clinking ghosts, Santa Claus in a parade, and oh yeah, that boy who was home alone. You know how the elf was home alone on a foggy Christmas Eve helping an angel get his wings?
Todd Davidson here, one of the youth ministry directors at Church of the Resurrection. I'm so glad that you've joined us. This is our first week of the movie, Christmas movie series, and we're glad that you're here to join us to see how we see God and ourselves within the popular Christmas movies. So the first one on deck is Home Alone. Oh my goodness, this is a classic. You know the scene when like this little dude, Kevin, like slaps the aftershave on his face and goes, a classic movie scene from the 80s. I grew up as one of my favorite Christmas movies, as well as others. But today we're going to talk about Home Alone and specifically Kevin and some of the things that he goes through. Okay, so one of the first things is the movie starts out and all the family is all in this house together. They're getting ready for this trip. So it's the cousins, the aunts, the uncles, the moms, the dads, brothers and sisters, and they're all in this house together. And Kevin is not getting his way. In fact, he's the youngest and he keeps getting pushed around and bullied. And so mom is so frustrated with him that he walks him upstairs, and this is what happens.
There are 15 people in this house. You're the only one who has to make trouble.
I'm the only one getting dumped on.
You're the only one acting up. Now get upstairs.
I am upstairs, dummy. Third floor?
Go.
It's scary up there.
Don't be silly. Fuller will be up in a little while.
I don't want a super Fuller. You know about him. He wets the bed. He'll pee all over me. I know it.
Fine. We'll put him somewhere else.
I'm sorry.
It's too late. Get upstairs.
Everyone in this family hates me.
Then maybe you should ask Santa for a new family.
I don't want a new family. I don't want any family. Families suck.
Just stay up there. I don't want to see you again for the rest of the night.
I don't want to see you again for the rest of my whole life. And I don't want to see anybody else either.
I hope you don't mean that. You'd feel pretty sad if you woke up tomorrow morning and you didn't have a family.
No, I wouldn't.
Then say it again. Maybe it'll happen.
I hope I never see any jerks again.
Kevin, those words probably weren't the best thing to say to your madre, if you know what I mean. You know, sometimes our family gets the worst of us, like the worst self. Like, we do so good at school or work or other places, but we get home and we are our worst self. And that was Kevin in this moment. Let me share with you one of the worst selves I've ever done. We had a snow day when I was middle school age, and my parents had to work, so we were home and I had a little sister. And I was in charge of my little sister that day. The reason we had the snow day is because it was like really, really, really cold and they were worried about students being outside. Well, my sister was being so annoying that I tricked her into going outside and I locked the door and kept her out there. Now, the story gets exaggerated over the years, so she says it was like an hour or two. I think it was probably like 10 minutes or so. But either way, like it being that cold, it was not safe for me to lock my big sister outside in the cold, but I was so annoyed by her. Now, if I was like at church or school, would I have done that to somebody? Probably not. Like, I was like a super kind kid, but to my sister and to my family, I was not always my best self. And these are one of those moments. Now, mom and dad were very, very, very upset with me and probably wished they could have locked me away in the third story and never seen me again. And I was frustrated with my family because I was stuck babysitting my little sister and I didn't want to on the free day. I really wanted just like the whole house to myself and to like do whatever I wanted, kind of like this.
I made my family disappear.
Kevin, you're completely helpless.
You know, Kevin, you're what the French call les incompétents.
Kevin, I'm going to feed you to my tarantula.
Kevin, you are such a disease.
There are 15 people in this house, and you're the only one who has to make trouble.
Look what you did, you little jerk.
I made my family disappear.
Yeah!
isn't that great? Like, Kevin is just like a free person. He gets to do whatever he wants. He gets to eat what he wants. He gets to watch whatever movie he wants. He gets to sleep in the bed however he wants, and nobody's gonna bug him at what time to wake up or what time to go to bed or any of those things. Kevin is the ultimate free little man at this moment, and he has so much excitement with it. But what we know is, even in those moments, like, okay, a few hours of that by ourselves or a day of that by ourselves, like, we eventually start to get like a little scared maybe, or a little lonely, or realize that we really do have great people in our lives. And so, much like us, here's kind of what happens with Kevin.
I didn't mean it. If you come back, I'll never be a pain in the butt again. I promise. Good night.
So Kevin's sitting in bed, it's been a day or two, and he realizes, I was kind of a jerk to my family, and I really, really, really miss them. And like, he apologizes and wishes that they could be back with him. Hey, this is a theme in the Bible quite often, is that we do things wrong. The Bible characters, the stories we hear, they did things wrong, and they want to like fix those things. And so a lot of times it's called asking for forgiveness, or redemption, or finding ways to apologize to those that we love and care for. So we have this scripture here from Ephesians. Put aside all bitterness, losing your temper, anger, shouting, and slander, along with every other evil. Be kind, compassionate, and forgiving to each other in the same way God forgave you in Christ. Forgiveness is kind of the thing about the Bible, right? This is why Jesus came on the earth to live like a human, to be fully human and fully God, and to offer eternal forgiveness. Sometimes we need people in our lives to help us with this, and sometimes it's people that are like not the normal people that come into our lives, kind of like this.
I'm in kind of a pain lately. I said some things I shouldn't have. I really haven't been too good this year.
Yeah.
I'm kind of upset about it because I really like my family. Even though sometimes I say I don't. Sometimes I even think I don't. Do you get that?
I think so. How you feel about your family is a complicated thing.
Especially with an older brother.
Deep down, you always love them. But you can forget that you love them. And you can hurt them and they can hurt you. And that's not just because you're young.
So this guy, this old guy that comes over and talks to Kevin at the church is like the neighbor. But he's like this scary neighbor. Like, there's all these stories about this guy has been like killing people with like snow shovels and burying them or carrying them around like in the salt bin that he uses to salt the sidewalks. But what we know, we find out that these stories are not true, and that this guy is actually really kind and compassionate. So much so that he walks up to Kevin in a strange place while he's by himself and comforts him and gives him some advice. Well, later in this clip, Kevin goes on to give him some advice as well. So what do we have to learn from this? I love this clip. In fact, this is like a turning point in this movie for Kevin, because all of a sudden he feels brave and courageous to protect his house against the wet bandit burglars that are gonna come. But what we can learn from this is that like, we need people in our lives. And sometimes it's the oddest people that come to care for us. We need to be prepared to allow those people to come in and to care for us and to listen to us, to be good listeners so we can work through our problems. But we also need to be that to other people. We need to be prepared to listen and care for people. Listen to this wonderful scripture from 1 John. But if we confess our sins, he is faithful and just to forgive us of our sins and cleanse us from everything we've done wrong. Hey, there's gonna be moments that we do wrong, and we need to find the place to share those things, whether it's in small group, with our families, a good friend, of how those moments of brokenness and when we've been our worst self, how we can confess those and then find forgiveness. Sometimes it's hard to just pray those to God and say, God, take these from me. And that's what God asks us to do. But sometimes it's easier to see somebody face to face and talk it out. So my hope is that you find someone in your life that listens to you well, and that you be those people to others in your life, that you can listen to them well. All right, finally, when it comes to like listening and forgiveness, it comes to the end of the movie. Kevin has like defeated the wet bandits, kept them out of the house, and done all those hilarious things. That scene when like he's taken down the wet bandits is classic. But now what? Like, he's beat them, he's still home by himself, what's gonna happen? Well, his parents have rushed back from Europe. His mom has done all kinds of things, like all kinds of planes, ends up riding in like a box truck with a polka band to find her way back to Kevin. And as she comes in, here's what happens.
Merry Christmas, sweetheart. Oh, Kevin, I'm so sorry.
As you can see, Kevin was hesitant at first. Like, he saw his mom, but one, was like shocked that she was there, and two, he paused. What do you think he was pausing for? Well, here's what I saw. The mom turns to him, and Kevin, "Oh, I'm so sorry." Kevin's face lights up, and he runs to his mom and gives her a big old hug. Why is that? His mom has finally returned, right? Like, the thing that he had hoped for, he'd been so scared and alone by himself. Why did it take an apology? Well, they had conflict before. And a lot of times that conflict doesn't just fade away, right? We have to do something about it. And here's what it says in James. James 5:16. "Therefore, confess your sins to one another and pray for one another, that you may be healed. The prayer of the righteous person has great power as it is working." I love that. Confess your sins to those that you have been hurtful to. Kevin's mom says, "Oh, Kevin, I am so sorry." And then Kevin lights up and runs to her. All things are right again when we put our humility on and our stubbornness aside, and we admit to the places that we weren't our best self to those that we love and care for. That we weren't our best self to our schoolmates. We weren't our best self to those that we work around. And we ask for forgiveness so we can move on and grow in relationship. And even between mom and son in this movie, that's what it took, was asking for forgiveness, saying that she was sorry. And then they embraced. Friends, we have so much to learn from this about those that we love and that they matter to us. And it's not a sin to like want alone time, right? But to like fight and to pick on people and to be mean to them so they leave us alone is not the correct way. We need to learn how to use our voices and ask for what we need so that we can be whole, so we can be our best selves to those that love and care for us. So as you're in this holiday season, you're probably gonna mess up. But don't be afraid to ask for forgiveness. Don't be afraid to give out an apology so that we can grow in relationship with those around us. Hey, love sharing this message with you. We have more Christmas movies coming your way. We'll see you here next week. Take care.